good evening, everyone, and happy Shabbat to one and all. JB, I have a question for you. Are you with us this evening? All right.
Yeah.
How long did you spend researching the credibility of the Book of Enoch?
2 or 3 weeks. A couple hours a day, every day.
Did I ask you to do it?
No.
Did I help you do it?
Nope.
Did I consult with you along the way?
Not.
Did I influence your research in any way?
No, not really.
Nope. All right. And at the end of that time, you presented a paper, what, about 15, 20 pages long?
Yeah, somewhere in that range, if I remember.
All right. And then I did invite you to join us in a presentation of those ideas a few months ago, correct?
Yes.
And did you present your findings?
Yes.
Did I at any time correct you, change you, influence what you found?
No, you added a few facts and details I might have missed, but otherwise, no.
First, your conclusion about the possibility that it was written by Enoch. What would have had to have happened for this to have been written actually by the person Yahweh refers to as Enoch, who lived and died prior to the time Noah was even born, much less prior to the flood?
Well, let's see. He had to have written it, passed it down generation after generation, survived the flood.
Oh, by the way, why doesn't if he wrote it, why doesn't Yahweh mention that?
You would think that'd be something worth mentioning, especially if it's as important as people claim it is.
Right. I mean, Yahweh does mention to Moshe, you know, I'd like you to write down this Torah. He tells us every detail about his dealings with Noah and with Abraham. I mean, we know the ins and outs of everything that they said and did together. And there's no point where Yahweh says, hey, Abe, this has been really swell, but I really wish you would write this down in a book so we could pass it on. Did he ever say that?
No, not once.
No, he never did. And to Noah, he said, yeah, this whole ark thing has been a swell experience. I really liked yachting, but for this to have any value, could you please write it down for me?
Nope.
No, he didn't, did he? And so he didn't mention that with Enoch either, did he?
No. All we're told of Enoch is he lived this many years, and then he was gone.
All right, since the Book of Enoch claims to have that Enoch had this marvelous relationship with Noah, did Noah ever mention a relationship with Enoch?
Nope, it never came up once.
Did he mention having a book written by Enoch?
Nope, it doesn't get mentioned anywhere.
Now, Yahweh claims that he communicated directly with Noah, doesn't he?
Yes.
Is Yahweh a credible witness?
The most credible.
Okay. So if Yahweh claims that he communicated directly with Noah, and if we have a record of what Yahweh said to Noah, doesn't the Book of Enoch claim that it was Enoch that communicated? No, it wasn't actually Enoch. It was a malach. That it was a that it wasn't Yahweh at all, but one of his implements that communicated with Noah. Is that correct?
That's the claim.
So either the Book of Enoch is invalid in that regard, or the Torah is invalid.
And since the Book of Enoch claims the Torah for authority, it's invalid either way.
Oh, boy. That's a lose-lose proposition. That is a lose-lose proposition, isn't it? And Noah does not ever mention, nor does Yahweh ever tell Noah, you know, there's this Book of Enoch that explains my calendar, so I'd really appreciate it if you could make a special test for it and take it with you on the ark.
No, that never came up once.
No. Okay, so when Yahweh then meets with Abram, does he say, you know, we're going to have a schedule here, and that schedule's laid out in the book of Enoch. It was written, you know, more than 1,000 years ago, but Noah kept it on the ark. You could pick it up from him. So make sure you have that with you, because it's without that, there is no way for you to stay on schedule.
Yeah, that conversation never happened.
All right, that conversation didn't happen. Is there any place where Yahweh told Abraham, you know, it's important that you read the book of Enoch? There's really important stuff there.
No, that never came up.
That never came up, huh?
All right, so then we go from Abraham
by the way, the reason we're doing this is because we had a conversation this week with a fellow named Wayne that has created Wayne's World that thinks that the Torah is inadequate. And let's just speak a moment of that. What his claim would be is that there is no calendar presented in the Torah, so it's impossible to come up with any dates based on the Torah. Now, if that were true, if Yahweh said your attendance at Pesach is a life and death matter, your attendance at Matzah is either part of the covenant or estrangement, that there's only one path to me, and if you don't attend these meetings, you're not going to be part of my family. If God had done that and said, here's the timing for them, and not provided any means to ascertain that timing, what kind of a deity would he be?
He seemed to be a bit sadistic.
Yeah, it would be sadistic, wouldn't it? This is life and death, and oh, by the way, I'm not going to give you any clue as to how to determine the timing of this. But if you miss the timing, you're screwed. But I'm not going to give you that for another 1,200 years. By the way, how did they know the timing of the first Pesach as they were leaving Egypt if the calendar would not be presented for another 1,250 years?
They won it.
Why would Yahweh mention that the first month of the year is Abib, when the barley is green and growing in the kernel?
So we know when to start the year?
Why did Yahweh use the term Kodesh to describe the timing of a month, which Kodesh means renewal, and to renew? So it's obviously when light is being renewed on the surface of the moon. Why do you think he used the term Kodesh to establish the timing of that first month, which was Abib?
Because that's the time when it tells us how to know when a month begins.
All right, now when Moshe was asked to write down the Torah, and I mean, the Torah's long. I mean, the Bereshith account in the Torah, as God goes through all of these relationships, he goes through his relationship with Adam, he goes through his relationship with Noah, he goes through his apeship with Abraham and Yishak and with Jacob and how that migrated into Israel. He goes into a lot of detail, and he goes through the whole sojourn of what happened when they were in Egypt, and then every painstaking detail about Moshe. Did he ever once mention? Oh, by the way, there's a really essential book that I inspired called the Book of Enoch. And without that book, you're screwed, blued, and tattooed. Better pay attention to it. Or better yet, I'll tell you what I'm going to do. Since this Torah is supposed to be complete, lacking, nothing, and perfect, why don't we just do what I do on everything else? I'll tell you what's important. And so you will find affirmations of this elsewhere. Is any of the information contained in Enoch part of the Torah, or is there any mention of it?
Nope.
When does the first fragment of the Book of Enoch, what date does it, is that, the first fragment?
Somewhere around 200 B.C.
Okay. And that fragment, is it written in Hebrew or Aramaic?
Aramaic.
Mm-hmm.
In fact, there's not
that would be a problem.
Fragment
anywhere. And how complete is that fragment in Aramaic? No, it's very patchy. But 10% of Enoch, maybe? Or less?
Yeah, if that.
Okay. Somewhere between 5 and 10% of the book. How old is the oldest complete copy of Enoch? Dates to when?
It dates to the 18th century.
Whoa, 18th century. And what language is it written in?
Geez, which is an Ethiopian language.
So it's written in an Ethiopian language, and it dates to the 18th century, and the only evidence we have of an Enoch prior to then is in Aramaic, and it only covers 5% of the book, and that dates to the 2nd century BCE. Now, you know, we use the Masoretic text to compare it to the Dead Sea Scrolls, and I've done the math. They differ in one word out of every 14, and of those differences, about 90% of them are minuscule. And what I have found is that because of the Dead Sea Scrolls now, you can therefore correct the Masoretic text such that that what you're considering in terms of a text is about 95 to 97% accurate. And then if you redo the, if you pull away the diacritical markings, which were added to the Masoretic in the 11th century, and you look at the roots of each word, you can get somewhere around 99% to 99.5% accuracy. I would like you to tell our audience here and family, if you wouldn't mind, how similar is that 5% of Enoch that we have in Aramaic from the 2nd century to the 18th century Ethiopian text?
I haven't done the research on exact percentages, but I know there are large swaths of it that are in the Aramaic that don't exist in the Geese. Huge sections that do exist are very divergent. It's one of the reasons most every person who's ever looked at it will dismiss it.
Yeah, because it is what little we have in the Aramaic from the 2nd century, most of that doesn't appear in the Ethiopian copies. And the Ethiopian text will have sections that would be part of that 5% that aren't found in the Ethiopian. So you've got parts that are there that aren't manifest later, and parts that aren't there that are manifest later. And then you have the third problem, which is the parts that are in both are highly divergent.
Yeah.
You couldn't have.
There might be
more,
maybe 10 to 15% correlation, if that.
When you're dealing with correlations of 10 to 15%,
we would call that unreliable.
You're right. Completely unreliable. And then if you go in just to the presentation of it, it differs materially from the Torah, does it not?
Oh, yeah, yeah.
Markedly. And doesn't the Torah actually provide us a test that we can apply to, and a Devarim, to determine,
yep.
Because God wants us to know the truth, that didn't God give us two examples of a test, first part of screening, you know, do we even use this to determine whether the text is for me? But then the next part is a challenge to say, you know, here are the things that you have to find. It's got to be consistent with what I've written. It has to contain prophecy. 100% of the prophecies have to be correct. It has to be correct historically. And if it does not conform to what I've said previously, if it does not conform to history, and if it does not contain prophecy that's 100% accurate, then what does God say about it? It's coming from him.
False prophet.
He calls it death and deadly.
Right. Dead. Yeah, in fact, it's actually a deadly document. And does not Enoch fail on all three of those that it's inconsistent with Yahweh's testimony, it's invalid historically, and it's also invalid in terms of it has no accurate prophecy.
Yeah, fails all of them miserably.
And then it's got some real buttes in there. It's got a 5,000, race of 5,000 foot giants.
Yeah.
It's got oversexed Moloch. In fact, just sex.
Oh, they're everywhere.
Can't have an oversexed Moloch. They're everywhere. And it's got a mountain that reaches all the way up in the heavens. It's got a mountain that's made of pearl, of all things.
Yeah.
So it's inaccurate scientifically, inconsistent with the Torah, and it has no valid prophecy. And oh, by the way, it differs about 90% from the oldest text. Do I have that right?
Yep. Yep.
So would
that's
you
about the gist of it.
Would you toss out the information Yahweh presented in his Torah regarding the timing of his seven invitations to meet and his Shabbat in favor of a book like this?
God, no. I wouldn't even waste a minute on that book.
But that's Wayne's world. All these people that have written us saying that you don't have a calendar in the scripture you're viewing, which would be the Torah, and therefore God was sadistic in telling people they had to meet with him on these days or face life and death consequences. And yet it's all answered for you in this book that has, on a 1 to 10 scale of credibility, is a zero.
I'll probably put it in the negatives.
It's astonishing. I mean, this is worse than believing the Quran. You'd have to put it on that same scale.
Mm-hmm. No, it's worse.
It's
worse
what
because
it reminded me of when I was going through it.
No, it's worse.
Stuff straight out of the Quran, almost.
Yeah, the reason it's
that was
worse.
My part is that almost everything that you found reminded me of the Quran.
Yeah.
Well, it does, but it's worse than that because they're pretending to rep for Yahweh.
Yes, yeah, correct.
You know, the Quran reps for Allah. You know,
right.
I mean, it's
now,
two different.
I had several people that wrote me because I shared the exchange that either said, you know, you're crazy to do this. Why are you doing this? I mean, this guy is a lost soul. I mean, just don't bother. But three of us bothered. You, Larry, wrote him. I wrote him a number of times, and James, you wrote him. There's a reason we bother. If he was deceived, and he was deceived on his little old lonesome, I wouldn't give a rat's patootie. Really wouldn't care. Mean nothing to me. But if he is deceiving, and then he confronts us with his deception, now I care a lot.
Yeah.
You know, I look at the fact that Yahweh has this tendency to walk the walk and talk the talk. It's remarkable that way. He tells us what we ought to do, and then he himself does it. For example, he himself routinely exposes and condemns all religious deceptions, all testimony that is corrupt and misleading. He doesn't walk away from it. He confronts it. He exposes it, he condemns it, and he demeans the people that are saying. In fact, we did a show, Kirk, this afternoon, where Yahweh said about every derogatory thing you could say about a person, speaking of how sick and perverted the Yehudim had become as a result of their religious behavior.
Correct, yeah.
Couldn't get any worse. I mean, he just says, no. I mean, you've got menstrual cramps in your thinking. Your brain is absolutely dysfunctional.
You're dead from the head to the feet. There ain't nothing left.
You are dead. You're dead from the soles of your feet all the way to the top of your head. You're so perverted that your children are perverted. I mean, I don't know what he could say. I mean, he says, what in the world makes you think that I want any of this rubbish that you're sending my way? Why are you so self-abusive? Again, God could not be more condemning of them. Why? Because that stuff's deadly. Because it's the right thing to do to expose and condemn that kind of attitude. Look at Yosha. Did Yosha, when he was confronted by the scribes and the Pharisees, the overtly political and religious types, did he just walk away and say, you know, let them be. You know, they're doing the best they can do. It's not my business. Let's coexist and let's just all get along. Is that what he did?
No.
Did he love them?
No.
Did he judge them?
Put the truth in front of him.
Did he go beyond just putting the truth in front of him, or did he slander them, because that would be to suggest it was in. Did he absolutely lambast them, expose, condemn, demean, degrade? Did he use really derogatory terms in his description of them?
No uncertain terms.
Yeah. In fact, they were derogatory, weren't they?
Mm-hmm.
But Yahweh even says, listen, those people who pray to me, who forego the Torah, as far as I'm concerned, they've got dung all over their faces. It's pretty derogatory, isn't it?
Yes, sir.
Yeah.
So we did, when we confronted this nincompoop Wayne, we did exactly what we were asked to do. And, of course, his response to the 20-page analysis of Enoch,
was nothing.
Said, oh, no, he had one argument. James, you've been brainwashed by Wynn. Yeah, you've been brainwashed by me. Now,
apparently I'm incapable of thinking for myself anymore.
I guess you are.
What should I have for dinner?
That's why I asked you. I said, so what part of the of your research on Enoch did I influence? I must be really good at this. You know, in fact, I have figured out that I must have been must have influenced Yosha, too, to get him to avoid mentioning Enoch. Well, during the sermon on the Mount. And I must have somehow influenced him not to explain that he was fulfilling Pesach, Matzah, Bakutim in accordance with Enoch as opposed to accordance with the Torah.
You know,
I must have brainwashed him.
D. Powers and I had it out with this idiot under a YouTube, okay? This guy's a cross between Forrest Gump and the Rain Man. You know, he's like a guy over here beating his head on a wall. He's a complete asshole, if the truth be told. And he's not
a
guy.
But the fact that he's been, listen, the world's full of disgusting individuals. And he is. He's the worst of the worst.
He's one of them.
He's a filth. But the problem with him is that he evidently has some degree of following, and he is misleading people in the name of Yahweh. That is something we care a lot about.
Well, that's why we attacked him on YouTube. I got to the point where I was just making fun of him. You understand that? I mean, there was just nothing
left
to do. Yeah, you know, I asked him who taught him how to whore. Was it his two-panty granny or his mammy? And, he went through the roof, you know. If Yahweh's words don't matter, why do mine? Somebody just put something up in the chat room where I looked at the forum, and there's all these people that seem to be angry with my no-holds-barred, type of attitude or whatever. You know what? When we find somebody, they bring in, we had a schizophrenic in a group. And he brought in this Sherry Schreiner, who actually has argon stones or something like that. They're blasters. And she actually accused Dee Powers of being a lizard person. And her followers said, Sandy, who's in our group, she had slits in her eyes, and they were thinking that we were lizard people. If you can believe this shit. And they're out there supposedly repping for Yah, and then, of course, everything's really just Christian New Testament nonsense. Actually, these people should just be dead. I mean, that's all. Right? They're the walking dead. They're just walkers, and they all just need to go away. They just need to go away.
By the way, the disgusting vermin is actually in the chat room.
You are kidding me. You are kidding me. This horse's ass.
He's in the chat room.
I already kicked him out.
Well, good.
I got rid of that.
But he could probably still listen to the program. But anyway, I'm glad that I have come to know the scumbag who has misled people in this regard.
Yeah, he's a scumbag.
The scumbag that would discount the and degrade the Torah to suggest that it doesn't provide the timing of Pesach, Matzah, and Bikurim, when it does, and would degrade the Torah to say there's no way that you can observe the Shabbat without the Roman calendar.
Well, yeah, he kept bringing up the Roman. We're not fixated on the Roman calendar. What's that all about? I, you know, we don't use it.
He has a mantra, and that's all he can articulate.
I know, he kept repeating.
You know, one of the things he couldn't do. They have a mantra, and they can't go outside their mantra.
Look, he slings a 1611 Bible. That was his credibility. He's got one of these old 1611 Greek, Latin, King James Version. An amalgamation of Greek and the Latin text put into English, retranslated five times over. One of those, and he's an expert at.
Anything that was translated, any English Bible, any Greek text, prior to the last 50 years, is nothing but an amalgamation of texts that were so errant and so variant that they rendered the Christian New Testament completely unreliable. That's why Jerome went through that whole rant to the Pope. He said, what I got here is an absolute mess. Nothing agrees. I've got as many variants as I have texts. And so there is no credibility anymore. And so what I'm going to do is I'm going to take all these variants and I'm going to blend them into one, and then we'll claim that one is the truth. And of course, none of the 69 first, second, and third century manuscripts were available until the last 50 years. So you can't have them in a 1611 text. As a matter of fact, all you would have then is that absolute, total, and complete fraud,
right,
known as the Textus Receptus.
Right.
And, you know, the history of that is so disgusting.
We went through that.
Absolutely fraudulent.
That's appalling. It was written by a homosexual and an atheist. I mean, come on.
But forget about the fact that he was a Roman Catholic priest that was diddling other Roman Catholic priests and his own students, and that he had no credibility with the Protestants or with the Roman Catholic. The fact is, what he pulled off was an absolute fraud. He used 15th century manuscripts that were wholly inadequate, and he created his text based on 15th century Greek manuscripts.
I know. It's pathetic. I thought it was 12th century, actually, but okay, 15th century is even worse.
He had one text from the 12th. All the rest were from the 15th.
Okay, so 15th
And the one text he had from the 12th, he discarded because it was too variant from the other text. So we couldn't deal with it.
What I want to say about this guy more than anything, and this is his one mantra, and I hit him four times and never got a response, okay?
Yeah.
He couldn't tell the difference between Moed and Shabbat. In Bereshit,
he doesn't know anything, but all he wants to talk about is Shabbat. The reason that Yahweh has a calendar, there's only one reason he has a calendar. And there's only one reason he told us about the calendar.
It's for his Moed Mikra.
Not need a calendar, and Yahweh did not present a calendar on behalf of the Shabbat. The Shabbat is simply every seventh day.
Can you count the seven, people? You know, that's the question here.
Now, what's interesting about the Shabbat, even though you do not need a calendar, which is why, now you can say there's no calendar as to when to celebrate the Shabbat. There doesn't need to be one. There isn't any reason to present a calendar. It's just the seventh day. But if you wanted your seventh day to coincide with Yahweh's seventh day, which, by the way, he never asked you to do, it's his Shabbat, but the fact it's his Shabbat has nothing to do with the timing of it and has everything to do with its purpose.
The
fact is that this moron has absolutely no concept of the Moed Mikra, which are a billion times more important than the Shabbat. And he has absolutely no concept of the terms and conditions of the covenant, which are even more important than the Moed Mikre. But only as one trick pony, only wants to time the Shabbat based upon this fanciful book of Enoch, because there is no calendar undergirding the timing of the Shabbat presented in the Torah. And guess why there isn't one? Because the Shabbat has nothing to do with the calendar. It has nothing to do with the calendar. It has nothing to do with months. It has nothing to do with years. Nothing.
Now, can I ask Kirk something? And I don't want anyone to help Kirk. This is on you, Kirk.
Okay, Kirk. Okay. Kirk, by the way, didn't read any of this stuff, because Kirk just thought this guy was just
I read the first two. We had a great laugh, but then I haven't gotten to the other stuff.
Okay, here it is, Kirk, and you have to be able to do this. In Bereshith, Yahweh talks about two large luminaries, one that rules the night and one a greater one that rules the day. Mm-hmm. Now, they're for the purposes of MWD. Now, can you tell me what MWD, how you would pronounce that?
Moed?
Moed? Moed. Moed. Good job.
No, oh, wait, let me ask you this.
I'm out of my game.
Now, can you define Moed? Can you define Moed?
It's called out assembly. Moed Mikre.
It's a meeting. Yeah, it's a meeting called by the
Torah. Pastor, they used to say we have assembly.
Yeah, Moed would mean meeting. As a matter of fact, Yahweh used the term Moed to explain when the false prophet Paul would arrive. When Shaul, the plague of death, would arrive.
Fulfillment of the Moed. That's right.
So establishing a calendar for the Moed that are celebrated in the first month and then seven sevens from Bukutim. And then in the seventh month, the 10th and the 15th day of the seventh month, you do have to be able to determine for the Moed what is the first month and what is the first day of the month. Yeah, well, the fact that he tells you that the first Pesach was celebrated during Abib, and specifically says it's during Abib. And Abib is the time that barley is in the appears as a kernel within the stalk of the grain, and that it is green and growing. So the timing has to be, because he even calls the first month Abib. That's his first and foremost month, and he defines Abib prior to establishing it as his first month. So he defines that time, that the first month is when barley is green and growing in the stock. What time of the year does that occur? Does that occur in January? No. Does it occur in August?
Nope.
Does it occur in September?
Nope.
How about December?
Ain't happening.
All right. So that occurs right
there
at the timing of spring when the days and nights are about equal, the equidistant, we call that the vernal equinox. Isn't that about an average when barley, which is the first grain to actually sprout in this way, isn't that about time that you would see the kernel of grain and barley? Right around spring equinox?
Yes, I've actually done it, I guarantee it.
So now you know the general timing of the month of Abib. Now all you need to know is when to start the month. What's the Hebrew word for month?
Kodesh.
Shadash?
Kodesh. What does the word Kodesh mean?
Renewal. And it's a renewal of the
month. In Hebrew, since all nouns are defined by their actionable or verbal root, isn't the verbal root of Kodesh Kadash?
Yes, it is, actually. Yep, sure
is.
Yeah,
Kadash. Yeah, by the way, is Kodesh and Kadash, is there any difference in the way they're actually written in the Hebrew text?
Not at all.
There's none, is there? No.
Nope.
So it's actually Kodesh is Kadash. There's no difference. The verb and the noun are written identically.
Well, that's why I said it that way.
The only way that you could actually notice a difference between the verb and the noun is with a verb there is the likelihood that a relational stem will be added, and there is a possibility that it will be either conjugated in the perfect or the imperfect. Not every verb has a stem, but most do. Not every verb has a conjugation, but most do. And many, of course, have a mood. And so the only difference between the noun form and the verbal form, kodesh and kadesh, would be whether or not it is accompanied by a stem, a conjugation, and a mood. Otherwise, they're written the same. Now, kadesh means to renew, doesn't it?
Yes,
so now, if you're looking at the, if you're looking at the at a month, and the clue that God gives you is renewal. Renewal. Okay, month, kodesh. I define the definition of kodesh is renewal. Now, and you know that the entire world kept time using the moon phases. Would you pick for renewal a full moon when the light is going to start diminishing?
No. You'd pick a new moon.
Yeah, first sliver.
When
the light is beginning to renew, right? I mean, how stupid would you have to be to ignore that clue? I mean, I'm going to tell you, God doesn't hand it to you and say, oh, by the way, I think you are so stupid, human beings, that I can use a term for month that means renewal, and you'll never be able to figure it out. I may be right with Wayne. All right,
no,
so,
he was
by
right.
Way,
because
by way, just
can't
because
tell.
He constantly says that kodesh means to set apart. What is the Hebrew word for set apart?
Kodesh.
Kodesh.
Kodesh. Yeah. Does he use kodesh relative to anything important?
Oh, yeah. That would be the ruach. Yeah, set apart.
Yeah, it's the ruach kodesh, right? Is his covenant kodesh?
Yes.
Is the Shabbat kodesh?
Yes.
Are the mikreh?
Jerusalem is kodesh.
Is his name Yahweh?
All things Yahweh, Kodesh.
Or Kodesh, right, set apart. Set apart's a really important concept. The Shabbat, by the way, is set apart, too. It's Kodesh. Yosha is Kodesh, Kodesh, the most set apart. All right, so what we have here is now no interest in the fact that a calendar was absolutely unequivocally set for the Moed Mikre, which are the life and death meetings.
That would be that MWD that we were talking about.
The MWD, the Moed. He uses three different terms as titles. One is ubiquitous, Mikre. And Mikre is the plural of Mikra, based on the verb kara, and it means invitations to be called out and meet. That is the most, if there was a title that you could actually say Yahweh used as a name, it would be Mikre. Sometimes he uses Moed Mikre in conjunction. So these are the assigned meetings to be called out. And then there are the only other term that he uses besides Mikre and Moed is Chag. Chag. Okay, JD, what's Chag mean? Yeah, okay. Larry dubbed it. It's a festival feast. Chag is a festival feast. Those are the so he's defining these meetings as parties. By Moed, it means they're designated meeting times, and Mikre defines their purpose: invitations to meet, to be welcome, to be to read, to recite. It was a testimony. All right. So, in his presentation of Abib and Kodesh, and then the specific days of each month, Yahweh provides the calendar in the Torah to do.
I even think he talks about blowing the horn on the full moon.
Right.
Oh man, how bad does this have to get?
Yeah.
No, I'm sorry. Yeah. This is almost laughable.
So,
really.
Does Yahweh ever go and explain to us that the Shabbat is based on a calendar?
Nope. And that's whatever I was trying to tie together.
Since the only calendars that existed in the ancient world, they didn't have mechanization. The only calendars were based upon the phases of the moon, and everybody recognized, just as Yahweh knew, is that what you do is every 2 to 3 years you add a moon phase to keep the lunar calendar in sync with the solar calendar. And if you do that, you're extraordinarily accurate in terms of keeping your timing correct. And Yahweh's mechanism was simply a beep. Choose the renewal of light on the moon's surface that is consistent with the barley. And if you do that, you will end up adding a moon phase every 2 to 3 years.
By the way, can I add something here just real quick? He makes it, all these people that found this calendar in Enoch, this Ethiopian document, they all seem to be astounded. And by the way, on his Facebook page, it doesn't say 365 and a quarter days. It says 364 days. If you use 364 days, you're still going to lose over 10 years. You're going to lose 10 days. I'm telling you, you will.
Yeah. I just looked up the Enoch calendar, and it consists of two 30-day months, a 31-day month, and they do that four times, creating 364 days.
There's
a great quote from a calendar expert who says the Enoch calendar has been criticized as hopelessly primitive. With only 364 days, it would get out of sync with the seasons so quickly. In only 25 years, the seasons would arrive an entire month early. You know what? What other calendar do we know that has seasons that float around
the... In 100 years, they'd be 4 months early.
Four months away.
And by the way, Yahweh's calendar is over a 7,000-year period. I mean, they would invert multiple times over 7,000 years.
I just want to point something out here, and I understand he's listening. You know, to this day, the Persians celebrate their pagan, festival feast of Nowruz. It's based on the new year. They've been doing this for over 3,000 years.
The Babylonians
knew exactly when the new year started.
Babylon.
We didn't need the Book of Enoch for the Persians.
Which is the first civilization with recorded history, was the first to establish a solar lunar calendar that was precisely accurate.
Yes.
Unlike the Enoch calendar, which is not accurate.
No, it isn't.
But the Sumer was the first to do it. They passed it on to the Babylonians. The Babylonians and Assyrians conveyed it to the Egyptians. It was conveyed to the Persians. It was conveyed to the Greeks and to the Romans. They all of them, including the Chinese and Indians, everybody had a calendar, and every one of the calendars worked the same way. Everybody's calendar worked the same way. It was months were phases of the moon. Years were solar cycles, and they were kept in sync by adding a moon phase every 2 to 3 years.
Did you realize that in 150 years you'd be exactly ass backwards? Yeah, this is no
Correct.
Kidding.
Exactly.
You would be 187 days off.
Right. Right. Yeah, and then imagine that, because Abib is a spring harvest. Shabuah is a summer harvest, and Teruah is a fall harvest in 125 years. Now, over God's timeline, 125 years isn't a sneeze, because he has a 7,000-year timeline, that in 125 years, Yahweh's harvest times would be inverted.
Not only that, but you got Amos, 8:5 in Amos. He couldn't, they're right there at the new moon. Can you think at the harvest time at a new moon, and since it represents a harvest, it's pretty clear. Can you think of a mikra that actually entails the harvest right there during a new moon? Because I can, it's
now,
called Teruah.
Oh, by the way, this is the thing about Wayne is that he has no clue what the mikra are about.
Then he's just in over his head.
Mean nothing to him. The only thing that means anything to him is his Enoch timing of Shabbat. And he wants to be one of the 144 in Revelation.
Yeah.
And by the way, the likelihood of that being accurate in Revelation is slim enough.
Zero.
I mean, there's a reason that we don't spend much time in Revelation. The reason that we spend almost all of our time, if we're going to talk about anything in the Renewed Covenant, it's almost always Matanyah because it's the least tampered with. And he was an eyewitness. Well, you know, I'm quite certain that Yahweh in Hebrew conveyed his message accurately to Yahochanan around
that has been
67
destroyed.
The fact is, we do not have old copies of Revelation. We have nothing past chapter 17 prior to Constantine, and so it creates a text that is extraordinarily unreliable. And so it's just not, since it's not in Hebrew, and since it has been very poorly maintained, and we don't have old copies, you have to be really careful. Plus the fact there's almost nothing in it that has value that you don't also find in Daniel. And since we have really old copies of Daniel that predate this absolutely, just go there. So there's no reason to go there, but that's what he wants to be. So the Shabbat. Let's go back to the Shabbat. Would there be any
before
reason
we go on,
for
I gotta read you something real quick.
Okay.
I just looked up some of the Book of Enoch describing its calendar. Let me just read you this. Two verses describing part of it, just to give you an idea of the absurdity. And on that day, the sun rises from that portal and sets in the west and returns to the east and rises in the third portal for 1:30 mornings. It sets in the west of the heaven. And on that day, the night decrees and amounts to 9 parts, and the day to 9 parts, and the night is equal to the day, and the year is exactly as it to its day, 364. And it goes on, where'd it go? And then the sun rises on that day from the second portal, and sets in the west in the second portal, and returns to the east into the first portal, and for 1:30 mornings, it sets in the first portal in the west of the heavens, and on that day, the night becomes longer and amounts to the double of the day, and the night amounts to exactly to 12 parts,
double
and the
day
to 6.
Double.
Wow.
Double the day. Well,
from the perspective of Jerusalem, no.
Oh, Jerusalem.
Wow.
Yeah,
this must make space travel very dangerous for our astronauts.
If you're going to Rome, you could probably find that. But in Jerusalem? By the way, what is the portal? You know, this is, of course, written in Ethiopian, so who knows what the word for portal means. But Yahweh does speak of portals, when he speaks of portal, how does the word for portal in Hebrew differ from doorway?
It would.
That's a trick question. It doesn't. The word for door, the word for portal, the word for gateway, all the same. So what he's saying here is in Enoch is that the sun is kind of almost like the Quran. Has
coming out of a door. No, I was going to say this. I'm reading and listening to the Quran.
Yeah, comes out of a doorway. But
if I remember right,
Yahweh gave us his creation account and said it took 6 24-hour days for the perspective of the Creator at creation. And then we did the math in terms of the timing of court confinement and the microwave radiation.
And it's 6 24-hour periods of time. Yes.
And it's 6 24-hour periods of time. I mean, that's pretty
clear. Scientifically,
it's
perfect.
You get 14.7 billion years and 6 24-hour days.
I'd like to thank David for that 14.7.
And you are precisely accurate. What do you think that the fellow that created the universe and provided that testimony got the year wrong, the length of the year wrong?
Zero.
Zero.
Look, if the Persians knew how long a year was, do you think Yahweh did?
Right.
I'm guessing so.
On the Shabbat, let's just talk about the time in the Shabbat, where Yahweh just says, you know, it's every seventh day. And the seventh day is you. The 6 days you have work, and the seventh day you don't. And you know, during creation, he actually has not yet celebrated the Shabbat of creation. You know, it says the seventh day he rested, but that's putting Hebrew into English and providing Hebrew. Ascribing to the English a tense that is not in the Hebrew. the seventh day he rested, as in past tense in English, isn't presented in past tense in Hebrew.
Of course it's not,
and
because
say,
he hasn't done it yet. Sukkah hasn't happened yet.
Because the seventh day hasn't happened yet. The seventh day is during the millennial celebration of Sukkah.
Yeah, but you see, you have to have these understandings. Now, I want to ask Kirk one other thing. What does S-H-B-T mean, Kirk?
Shabbat, like the seventh day.
Whoa. So you mean Moed and Shabbat are two different things?
No. Shabbat.
Is that what you're
Shabbat
telling
means,
me here?
Yeah, by the way, Shabbat means more than seven.
Promise with a lot of things.
That means solemn
promise.
Yeah,
promise and oath, doesn't it?
It doesn't mean assembly.
Okay. And Daniel, did Daniel provide us with a timeline as to when the Matriarch, the one who was set apart for the purpose of serving, prepared to serve, did he provide a timeline when he would arrive in Jerusalem?
Yes, to the day.
Coming through the gate.
Yeah. To the day. And if you look at, I've forgotten the day, but it's like on April 4th, which on the Roman calendar would be 33 CE. This would be in year 4000 Yah. It would be 4 days before Pesach in year 4000 Yah. So it's the 10th day of the first month in year 4000 Yah. That's what it equates to. And that's the day, 4 days before Pesach, that the Passover lamb enters the home. Is that correct?
Correct. Yeah.
All right. That's when
according
he arrived,
to the instructions, that's correct.
That's when he arrived to be cut off, but not for himself. Now, in that particular year, in year 4000 Yah, in the celebration of Pesach, and it's astounding to me that Yosha knew when to celebrate Pesach when he never referenced this fanciful, erroneous calendar in Enoch, but he somehow managed to do it. And he has now asked his disciples 4 days later, I really want to celebrate the Pesach dinner with you. Are we able to deduce from the eyewitness account of Matan Yah what day of the week that was?
Yes.
Yeah, we are, because we're told that he became the Pesach lamb the following day, and at the end of that day they were hurried to get him off of the upright pole because it was going to be a Shabbat. Oh my, a Shabbat. So that means that he celebrated Pesach dinner with his disciples on a Thursday evening. That would be the evening of the fifth day as it transitions into the sixth day. The sixth day began when he began celebrating Pesach. It would have been the 13th day of the month as it became the 14th day of the month, and it was the sixth day of the week. And later on that day, he became the Pesach lamb. That would be a Friday as we reckon time, but the terms that we use, but that's still the sixth day, is it not?
That's correct. Yep.
And he gave up his spirit, went to Yahowah, and then his soul departed and went into Sheol right at the transition from the fifth day to the sixth day, correct? The fifth day to the sixth day to the seventh day, so that he spent the
that would be
his
correct.
Soul went into
he's
Sheol
spent,
on
a natural Shabbat in matzah.
Does matzah have a Shabbat associated with it? The Shabbaton, isn't it?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah, the Shabbaton. So matzah has a Shabbaton. So the Shabbaton of which would be to celebrate.
It's literally fulfilled on a natural Shabbat. Yes.
Yeah. There you go. And because absolutely. We then know that his soul and Yahweh's spirit, the set apart spirit, were reunited to celebrate first fruits on the first day of the week. Right. And by
that's
the way,
right.
So Daniel predicts exactly the time, and then we have the eyewitness accounts, and then we can look at the NASA moon phases, and you go back to 33 CE, which is year 4000 Yah. We know that for lots of reasons, not only the Daniel prophecy, but it's also 1,000 years after the cornerstone was laid in
lunar eclipse that day, too, so there was a blood moon. Yeah, isn't that interesting?
Yeah, it was. Mm-hmm. And so that was on a Thursday evening, which became the beginning of the Passover and then a Friday, and then on the natural Shabbat, his soul was performing matzah, only to be reunited with soul and spirit on the first day of the week to celebrate first fruits. And that timing and those days of the week are exactly what we're observing now. So we're observing it exactly as he observed. Mm-hmm. I'm not sure that it's all that important to have ours in sync with his, but that was his. And oh, by the way, the next most important Shabbat would be the Shabbat, the Shabbaton, that would be celebrated on Sukkah, on the day that Sukkah is fulfilled 5 days after Yahweh returns, is the Shabbat, is Sukkah, which
it
is
falls
a
on
Shabbaton.
A natural Shabbat. It falls on a natural Shabbat. Yes, it
and
does.
And you're 6,000, 33.
In the Mizmor 81.3, it talks about sound the ram's horn at the new moon, mm-hmm. and when the moon is full on the day of our festival. So there's a full moon on the day of Pesach, isn't there? I mean, there just is.
Always a full moon on, Pesach and Matzah, always full moon.
Always.
14th and 15th day, always a full moon. And Sukkah, where we camp out with God, always a full moon, 15th
full
day
moon.
Of the
month. And that full moon, there's going to be eclipse visible in Jerusalem, so that'll be a blood red moon, too. So there's two blood red moons that are kind of important, the day of fulfillment and another day of fulfillment. Wow. Imagine the accident there, because how often do you really have a lunar eclipse over one area?
Yeah.
And they just happen to manage to fall right there.
Yeah, they're actually over Jerusalem.
Yeah.
So no matter how you look at it, we have everything we need. But now I'm going to go one step further. When Hezekiah found an old copy of Enoch in the temple. Oh, no, I was wrong there. Found an old copy of the Torah. And he opened a copy of the Torah and read it. And he says, Houston, we have a problem. He said, we've got religious rubbish all over this place. And we have not been following the advice here in the Torah, and we've got Assyrians bearing down on our behind here and about ready to do to us what they did to Israel, which was to wipe the place off the planet. And so he said, maybe we ought to consider this, because Yahweh makes a lot of promises in here to defend his people. So he does his best to get the Lowy back up to speed and to cleanse the land of religious artifacts, but he runs out of time. He doesn't have enough time to do it. So he's in a position where he says, okay, we can celebrate at the right time, but the wrong way, because we're still surrounded with religious rubbish, and the Lowy aren't properly attuned to the purpose and meaning, so they can't really do it correctly in terms of communicating its purpose to the people. So he went to Yahweh and said, hey, what's more important to you? Do we celebrate this at the right time or the right way? In other words, then I have a two-week postponement. What did God say? Hell no. Look at the Enoch calendar. I told you when I wanted to do this.
No, he said, go for it, guys.
Right for it.
Yeah.
And then they postponed it 2 weeks, and then they started celebrating it. And then what did they ask of Yahweh after they had celebrated it?
Can we extend it another week? We had a good time.
Yes. And what did God say? Hell no. Look at the damn book of Enoch. I gave that to you so that you wouldn't screw this up with my 300 a year.
Go for it. Go for it.
I'm having a good time, too. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. It is obvious to anyone who has ever taken the time to think about it that performing Pesach on the right time, but having no clue as to what it represents, gets you nowhere. Gets you nowhere. With God. Nowhere.
You know, because it's funny, because Yahweh says that.
And they must have 1,000 rules that make the Shabbat observance all that more detailed and disciplined. And they have been doing that now for thousands of years. What did Yahweh say about them in the book of Yeshayah, Kirk?
You're wasting your time,
you're just wasting your time. Yeah. You're absolutely wasting your time.
Well, he got worse than that with them in the book of Malachi, where he said, your festivals and feasts are dung. That's, you know,
right. They're dung.
Yeah.
Yeah. I'm of the conclusion that it is true that Yahweh's instructions as to how to ascertain the first month of the year and the first day of that month, are not overly precise. First to admit that. And you have to deal with the fact that the likelihood of one renewal of the light on the moon versus another right around the time that barley would be in the kernel. And barley, by the way, was ubiquitous back then. I mean, that's how they made their bread. It's how they made their beer. And beer was essential because without brewing beer, everybody would die with the drinking of the water. And the bread was an essential food start. It was everywhere. And it was a much more agrarian culture. So it's not like today where you don't have a whole lot of barley around. But there are times when you've got a new moon that is very close to being equidistant to the time that barley would be green. So there's probably one year every 20 that you had to scratch your head and say, hey, is it this renewal or the next renewal?
This was one of them. This year was one of them.
Yeah, this year was one of them. Now, there was actually one new moon that was 4 days closer than the other. But, you know, that's a possibility. The second is that while he says Kodesh, and, you know, we said Abib, so Abib's going to get you close, but Kodesh to renew, does that mean that light would begin to renew on the surface of the moon before sundown? Or is after sundown, because, you know, the NASA site has that data anytime prior to midnight, because, you know, the accounting for days has changed from sundown to sundown. And, you know, how much of it has to be there for you to count it? And can you calculate it, or does it have to be observed? And so that is not precisely answered. And so you could have a thoughtful, aware, discerning individual disagree by one day. And every 20 years or so, there's the possibility that you could disagree by 29 days. Now, that being the case, do you think that Yahweh would have gone into, say, okay, when it's close and you're equidistant in terms of a renewed light on the moon, a Kodesh, for Abib, one way or the other, this is how you resolve it. And, oh, by the way, this is the amount of light that is necessary, and this is the vantage point, and this is what you do if it's a cloudy day. If God was really hung up on the most important thing was to be right on the day versus to be right on the message, what would he
He would have been a lot more specific in the instructions. He would have been a lot more specific in the instructions. It's as simple as that.
Now, he was really specific on the instructions, but not on the timing.
That's what I'm saying. I'm talking about specific on the timing of it. And that's just not there.
But he spends all of his time instead on
the understanding.
On the understanding. Month, life, and death.
Well, of course, if you're obeying commands, you really don't care to understand anything. You're performing sort of like a dancing bear at the circus.
Yeah.
you know. And so you just, that bow, you bow. You know, stand on one leg, you stand on one leg. And
right.
You wave at the crowd, you wave at the crowd. And then you get rewarded because you've been a good little dancing bear at the circus.
Yeah, so there is no instruction as to what the seventh day is. But son of a gun, you know, with the religious Jews, with all of their corruptions, they were still observing the Shabbat, consistent with the way that Yosha, because it says that, as was his custom, Yosha went into the synagogue on the Shabbat. And on the Shabbat, he would go in and read the Torah scrolls, which tells us how to spend that day as well, following his example. And he even fulfilled the Mikre on natural Shabbats. So we know that as bad as the Yehudim were, they still managed to keep their Shabbats in sync with what the exact same thing that Yosha observed. He didn't say, oh, by the way, your timing on your Shabbat is all screwed up. No, I'm going to do it on Wednesday while you're doing it on Saturday. And when the disciples say, hey, we had to even get them off that upright pole because, it's in a few hours it's going to be the start of the Shabbat, didn't say, and our timing on the Shabbat here is different than what Yosha observed it, did they?
No. Nope. Sure didn't.
Why would you disregard all of that?
Well, wait a minute. There's one other thing.
Of something as preposterous as Enoch, unless you were a self-serving moron.
Well, there's one other thing.
Aggrandize your own personal insights and revelations.
Right. Well, there's one other thing. First of all, you're going to Enoch, and there's one other book he talks about Jubilee, and I just want to mention this real quick. If I go to a website,
if you don't even know the name,
that's my point.
And the purpose of the Yobel, then you are lost before you begin.
Yeah. If I go to a website and it says Jesus loves you, how much of that do you think I'm going to read?
Zero.
Know me?
If you don't know his name, you don't know him.
Why would you call a Yobel a Jubilee?
Because year 4000 Yah was a Yobel year, which means 33 CE was a Yobel year, which means 2033 was a Yobel year, and 968 BCE, when the cornerstone of the of Yahweh's first temple was laid, a Yobel year. All of this happens in a Yobel, and Yosha fulfilled Pesach, Matzah, Bekorah, and Shavuah in a Yobel year. In fact, not just a Yobel year, but year 4000 Yah, the Yobel, because the Yobel is so important in understanding the purpose of these. You know, all slaves are free, all debts are forgiven. The land
isn't that what Shavuah is about? Because you're counting seven sevens from Bikurim plus one, and if you go back that plus one, that's matzah. That's when you're restored and made perfect.
Wow,
Yobel built right into the Moed Mikre. And then I've got to ask a question. If you see a book called The Jubilee, would you read that book?
No.
Thank you. I wouldn't either. That's like saying Jesus. It's just stupid.
Yeah. I've spent the last 12 years of my life trying to translate and understand the Torah and the Mizmor and the Navi. And I have probably translated and contemplated and shared insights on 10% of it, 20% of it. That's 10 to 15 years of my life. And, you know, working 6 days a week, 8 to 10 hours a day. And why would I want to go off on a book that clearly has no proof, in fact, it has all evidence to the contrary, of divine inspiration, when I could spend the rest of my life coming to understand Yahweh by continuing to translate and amplify and consider the testimony that I'm absolutely certain that he conveyed? You know, I'm dealing with Barashit again because of something that was said in Yeshayah 3:1, and so I've gone back and I've covered everything related to the formation of the covenant with Abram in Barashit. I have translated those passages probably 10 times. You know that every time I go back, in fact, this time through, I'm translating.
You find more.
Not just more. Profound. I mean, to the point where you sit there and my jaw falls down to the top of the desk, and I just sit there and say, wow, that. What did I tell you the other day? We were saying, you know, my conversations with Yahweh are, he talks, I listen, and my response is, wow.
Yeah, well, you know, check it out, dummy. You share those insights with us every Shabbat, in case you don't remember, and they are profound. They're very profound.
Yeah.
You know, it's profound. There was one we were talking about Bereshith. Remember the stupid line in the religious material? Well, you stand over there by the donkey. We'll go up here and worship, and we'll come back here. You know, and then it turns out it's, you know, we're going to walk into eternity. And then of our own volition, we're going to come back here and show you how. That, you know, that's also very telling because of our own volition, it's up to us who we want to spend eternity with.
Correct.
In other words, he doesn't have to tell them. It's of his own volition.
No.
It's of his own volition.
Yeah, it's like I don't have any interest in sharing the Torah with somebody who is belligerent or religious. Or political.
Yeah, right. Of course. There's plenty of people I don't want to spend eternity with. Why would I tell them how to get there? I'm not interested in them being there. You know? I don't want to have Hitler there.
I've told Wayne very early on, I have no interest in sharing the Torah with him. None. I don't spend eternity with him.
There's no point to it.
No point.
He's bowing down to a lord.
I don't want to be around him. I don't want to be associated with him. I don't want him in there.
He does something else, too. He makes a mockery of Yahweh's words. First of all, to say Yahweh doesn't know how many days are in a year. Excuse me? I mean, that's quite an insult right there.
Yahweh doesn't know that there aren't mountains made of pearl. Yahweh doesn't know there's no mountain on earth that reaches into the heavens. Yahweh doesn't know there's no 5,000-foot giants. You tell me that Yahweh doesn't know that his malach are not sexual beings? You're telling me that Yahweh had a senior moment and forgot whether it was he or some malach that spoke with Noah?
Yeah, he's making a mockery of Yahweh. This is what these books do.
I don't want to spend my eternity with somebody like that, nor does Yahweh.
And it's what religious translations do with the Torah, by the way. So this is why he slings the 1611 and the book of Joshua. See, people like him, they have to have secrets that no one else knows.
Well, that's the first thing he wrote.
That's how they feel important.
I've been given insight and secret knowledge that no one else has.
Nobody else has.
Right.
You get someone who's claiming special revelation, you're beyond ignorant and rational and move to delusional.
Let me ask you, I've got a question for you, Yada.
Sure.
You've translated a lot. I've made them notes and shared them a lot. Uh-huh. How many times do you suppose Yahweh says they're going to take my name out of my words? Or, you know, decries the fact nobody will use my name? Many. How many times?
In fact, they actually took it out 7,000 times. But the thing that's so amazing is that the third statement, he etched in stone, was aware that they were going to do it. The third statement in the stone says, when they do it, you ought to know that there is no forgiveness for this. This is an unforgivable act to have my name.
Right. I will not fail to punish, he says. By the way, he like our boy, Rain Man, just like the rest of the religious people, he thinks that meant something to do with God damn. He really did. He said so.
Oh, wow.
By the way, what
is the word damn mean?
Being separated.
Right. Yeah. And is God a name or a title?
It's not a name. Well, it's not a noun. It's a title.
By the way, does God use the term El and Elohim to describe false gods?
Yes, he does.
Mm-hmm.
Over and over.
What was the name of the chief Canaanite god?
El.
El. Okay. And so the English word God is simply a translation of El, and a plausible translation of Elohim is used in the plural, as you know, in Hebrew a great deal. It's from Eloah, and it shows God both as our as the sacrificial lamb.
It means different manifestations of the same being is all plural means.
So that's how it's presented. Does God damn?
Yes. Oh, yeah. Absolutely.
A lot. Right. Yeah. As a matter of fact, God damns the sentence, doesn't it?
Yeah.
And so saying God damn, in the context of saying what is being presented, what is being misrepresented, God damns. And
yeah, sure.
And God damns the individual that is misrepresenting his testimony. It is a extremely important concept. God damn religion, for example. God damn Enoch.
The book of Enoch.
The book of Enoch.
Yeah, I got a question. But here's the question. So we know that Yahweh gets really upset on important things, and he points them out, by the way. Can you tell me where in his words Yahweh says, you've changed the day of my Shabbat anywhere?
No.
Never.
No, never.
Why do you think that is? I don't think it happened.
Because it never happened. By the way,
wow.
he doesn't accuse them.
Somebody just wrote goddamn way.
He accuses them of mixing the purpose of them with the Babylonian Gentile religion.
He does not accuse
corrupting them. But he never accuses them of celebrating
changing the time.
Okay.
I know.
No, I didn't change the time.
I know, and you point this out to these people.
The Hebrew calendar is right most of the time as it relates to Pesach Matzah, and they don't celebrate Bukkudim, but it's right most of the time. It's right most of the time on Yom Kippurim. Pardon?
I mean, if you started out with 40 years of Moshe, and that was followed by all those years where Yahusha been none, I mean, they have a pretty good start, and they never left it. They were very learned. They were kept writing everything down. They kept the same. They just, it's always been.
By the way, did Moshe say, rather than writing this Torah thing down and making this information available for everybody, I really like the idea of having secret knowledge. So I'm going to keep the secret knowledge.
How much open?
Do you think
that
if God was to
having
secret knowledge, that Moshe might have been the guy?
Yeah.
I think so, wouldn't you?
Yeah, I mean, my Torah is complete. You'll hit on every note. I mean,
I'm a really smart dude. I'm so smart that my genes created Solomon. That's how smart I am. But I am so damn smart that the key here is that I've analyzed the Torah and all the stuff that I wrote about how you can benefit from the Torah. That's just the tip of the iceberg here. What I really possess that I'm not going to share with you is my own secret knowledge. Or maybe I have secret knowledge. I'm going to write different psalms about my secret knowledge, so it's no longer secret.
Yeah, you can't have a mystery religion if you don't have a mystery.
Yeah. Did Yahweh say that his Torah was complete?
He did.
Yes, he did.
And perfect.
Yeah, lacking nothing.
Lacking none.
Yes, he did.
Did he say that, you ought not add any secret knowledge?
Yes, he did.
Don't take away from it. Don't add to it. And what did Yahusha say about the jots and tittles, the smallest letters and the strokes of the letters?
Don't even mess with the letters.
Yeah, don't annul any of them. None of them will be negated so long as the heavens and earth exist. I'm looking outside my backyard. Looks like it's still around.
Yeah.
You're kidding.
Yeah.
You still here?
It's got a pretty good thunderstorm going right now. It's kind of looking ominous, but it's still there.
How you doing over there, James? You're a bastard, too.
I want to make something perfect.
Sure.
None of what J.B. did in terms of his writing, nothing Larry did, nothing I did, had anything to do with Wayne. Nothing. Don't care about it. It means nothing to me. We do have an obligation, though, and I don't like the term obligation, but I don't know what the right term is in English, because compelled is not right either. But there is something in us once we become part of the covenant, once we come to know Yahweh as he revealed himself, that there's something in us that says, do as Yahweh has done. Do as Yosha did. Do as Yahweh says. Do as Yosha says. And if you look at what they said and did, any time they witnessed somebody misleading others in his name, they confronted
them. He attacked
them.
He confronted them.
Said, you know, that not only demeaned the individual, calling them scum, but he exposed the lie, condemned the lie, and presented the truth. Always. Now, it doesn't mean that he reached out. Did he really care what the Spartans were doing?
No, he didn't.
Did he really care what the Carthaginians were doing? You know, I don't care what the Scientologists are doing to one another. I really don't care. I don't care what the Mormons are doing to one another. I do not care what the socialist, secular, humanists are doing to one another unless they're doing something that is precluding many people from knowing the truth about Yahweh. And, of course, in socialist, secular, humanism, I'm going to attack it because it exists to nullify people's ability to exercise good judgment. And I'm going to attack and criticize Christianity because I care, because they piled their corruption right on top of Yahweh's truth to mislead people. And since there's 2.5 billion people deceived by Christianity, I'm going to go out of my way to criticize it. And if somebody writes me to promote a lie and they say that they have a web presence where they have a large audience that they are sharing these lies with, it is essential to go after them. And not because of who they are, but because of what they're saying and what they're doing. And it doesn't mean that there's, you know, we're smart enough to know that. And when, J.B., when you presented the 20-page analysis of Enoch and Lazarus fraud, I told you, listen, if you were a rational person, it would be over. But this is not a rational purpose. It's not going to have any effect whatsoever, and that's what happened. But that doesn't stop you from doing it. It's important to do. And the reason why it's important to have out there and to have it posted in the forum and have it posted on the Bless Yahweh site of Richards and discussed at places like Frank's site is because there are people who will be influenced by such lies and think that some Enoch timing in of the celebration of the Shabbat is more important than understanding the purpose of the Shabbat, more important than understanding the purpose of the Moed Mikre and answering those invitations, more important than knowing what the terms and conditions are of the covenant and responding to them, and the person who is misled that still has an open mind can probably be helped.
Yeah.
And that's why we do it. That's why. Did Yosha think, and JB, your study on Enoch was pretty astute. Are you as smart as Yosha?
No.
Did Yosha, when he confronted the scribes and Pharisees, is there any indication that he prevailed with them?
None.
No.
No. In fact, the only indication that maybe one of them listened is Nicodemus, and you got to really be worried about Nicodemus too, because he's named after the Greek god of victory.
So I'm Nike.
We got a problem. We got a problem with a Hebrew bearing that name. And of course that story appears in the opening of Yahuchanan. And the Yosha's diatribe against the Pharisees and the Sadducees takes place in the 23rd chapter of Matanyah. And so, you know, we have a timing thing here. So there is absolutely no indication he prevailed with any of them, is there?
Yeah.
So he's pretty, when it comes to presenting his case, exposing and condemning lies and presenting the truth, I would rank Yosha right up there with Yahweh.
Oh, yeah, since he is Yahweh, but yeah, sure,
yeah,
I would too.
Okay, so, and he didn't prevail, did he? He didn't convince one of them.
He didn't prevail with us, because we prevailed.
Now, wait a minute, Yahweh said that Yeah, that's true. But Yahweh said
that's
that
why,
the religious
but that's why,
were
that's
so
why we
stupid,
confront,
he couldn't
that's
help.
Why,
that's
and
why
that
you
is
do
why,
it.
By the way, he confronted them. He knew he couldn't save them. We did not confront Wayne because we thought we could benefit Wayne. Yahusha did not confront the scribes and Pharisees because he thought he could benefit them, that he could awaken them, that he could change them. He did it for our benefit. We responded for the family's benefit. We responded for those the family loves that should, that may have been enticed by these people who were still open to the truth. We did it for them. He did it for them. We're following his example. It's the right thing to do. You know, when we started the book of observations for our time, based upon William the Elevator Man's questions regarding Proverbs 6.
Yeah, because William's always stirring things up.
Right, he was stirring things up. He wanted to know who the whore was, and there's a lot of things in Proverbs 6 that are really provocative and interesting. And that's where we began this whole process. And almost everything that we are sharing right now, you can derive from Yahweh's presentation right there. And one of the things that he said is that if you have made an oath to any human institution, you need to get down in the mud, get a little dirty, and bluntly and boldly, unequivocally, go and explain why you're what your grievances with them. Absolutely. When Yahweh began Yashaya, he began it by telling us that the covenant is the only thing I cared about. I started off with a family. I raised you. I lifted you up. I did everything I could to nurture you. I did my best to make you great, and you rejected me. And then he goes and explains that their rejection was based on religion. All God wants is a family. And when we detoured, we get in any way, shape, or form away from the prime directive, which is Yahweh's offering us membership, participation in his family, and does everything necessary to enable us to not only live with him, but to be so similar to him that we can spend an eternity together exploring the universe and having fun together, that there really is nothing more than you need to know about Yahweh's word, that he has offered participation in his covenant. And anytime you want to talk about anything else, any detail apart from that, it's irrelevant.
Does
the only thing that
does
matters
mean that
is
not
does it point to the covenant.
Does it
Kirk,
mean that somebody just, they're just not satisfied with what Yahweh said, so they keep looking? I mean,
I don't
know what it says to me. I'm saying, what's wrong with you? This isn't satisfying.
Yeah, that you become popular based upon some mantra that you're promoting. And so the idea of your mantra being untrue and you losing your popularity and your credibility by having to admit your mantra is not true is beyond what they're able to do. You know,
since we're speaking of this.
You know, Larry, how many times do you think that I've admitted that I'm wrong?
Hundreds that I've
heard. Yeah, countless. Matter of fact, in the chapter I'm writing right now, there's two statements where I said, oh, well, here we go again. I missed that one.
Yeah, where you're not wrong, you're just getting deeper. But I got a question for
you.
Yeah,
it's mostly missed how really significant and deep it all is. And sometimes it was wrong, and I believe that there was.
Have you ever heard of the term projection, Yada?
Yeah.
Projection? Okay.
Yes.
When somebody tells you that you're holding God's money, This is what this guy's accused you of, and that we're in a cult.
I didn't know God had any money. I didn't know he had any money.
He didn't have any interest in money, to be honest with you.
Well, wait, I'm holding it. So where am I? Where have I put it?
Where in the hell is it, right?
Yeah,
I'm trying to figure out how he's projecting.
Can I write a check on it?
Yeah, I don't know. I guess you can. You're holding it.
I didn't know I found it.
I know this. How much money have you spent getting Yahweh's words out? Not that you would brag about such a thing, but just roughly.
Hundreds of thousands of dollars.
Okay. And so, have you ever had anybody give you any money? Have you ever had me give you any money?
No.
Wow. No. What's going on with your cult there?
There are many people who have offered. I just always said, no, thank you. No, it is my thrill and honor to be able to do this. But you know what I realized with Yahweh? He didn't want my money.
Yeah, you think?
Maybe he wants a cow. It is irrelevant. The one thing that I have invested that is meaningful to me and meaningful to him is my time.
Yes,
I've invested a lot of my time. Now, the interesting thing about investing time with Yahweh is you get it back multiplied by an infinity six times over.
Yeah, of course.
Yes.
Yeah.
So it's the ultimate.
We're trying to keep our eye on the prize over here.
Now, one of the things that is really helpful is to constantly be willing to admit you're wrong.
Yeah.
And it's really helpful because if you're not willing to admit you're wrong, then you're incapable of learning. If you don't have an open mind, you're never going to come to know Yahweh anyway. And, you know, it's important for us to know we're flawed, we make mistakes, and that learning is fun. And if you learn something that is contrary to something you previously thought was true, the most wonderful, liberating, enlightening, beneficial thing to do is say, hey, guess what? I was wrong about that. But here is an insight now that is considerably better than what I previously understood. It's really fun. You know, like one of that I missed is that I've always stated the first term and condition of the prerequisite of the covenant is to walk away from Babel, walk away from your country, from human cultures and society, and from the family of man. And I've said that's the prerequisite of the covenant. Not completely right. What did I miss?
I mean, it's walking away from a mindset, though. It is.
True. Okay, what I've said isn't inaccurate, but it isn't complete.
Well, there you go.
That is not the first condition of the covenant. And I've had it in my face a gazillion times. I've talked all around it. But the fact is that what I just said is incomplete, and I must have said it, you know, I've got to have said it 10,000 times. It isn't complete. That's not how Yahweh presented it. Yahweh said, I want you of your own free will to walk away from your country. And he defined the country as Babel. So Babel is religious and political corruption. I want you to walk away from your country.
And that's correct.
Religious and political corruption. I want you to walk away from your community and culture and customs, because they also have an influence on you. And I want you to walk away from the family of man, your father's home, your family of man, because you only can have one father, and I want to be your father. There's only one family, and you want to be part of my family. All that's true. Then he says to the land that I'm going to show you. The prerequisite of the covenant isn't just to walk away from religion any which way you please. To walk away from religion and politics, from human cultures, from the family of man, in one particular direction towards God's home. And if you don't complete it, you could go off and walk away from these things and end up in any number of places. It's not going to do you any good. The first condition of the covenant is to walk away from to God's home. Mm-hmm. It's right there. Yeah. Let's never put it together.
You've got to walk in the right direction. I think you've always talked to people that way. You just didn't say it.
But the first condition, the prerequisite of the covenant, is more than just walk away from your country, the corruption of politics and religion, from the societal customs and culture, and from the family of man, because it says walk away from those things.
Yeah, we now have a picture of a cow and it's got a dollar bill on it, and buckets of money are coming out. It says, "My contribution to Yada."
Oh, thanks.
This is an unpopular truth now. Yeah, by the way,
it's out there handing it over. I want to speak about because you asked me about money. I want to just speak on that.
Yeah.
I paid a tremendous price, too high a price, really, in business, to earn the wherewithal to be able to do this. Paid way too dear a price. But something positive has come from that. One is the ability, I'm still young enough to be able to have a pliable mind and be able to do this in a way that's enjoyable and useful. And it gave me the freedom to spend 6 days a week, 8, 10, 12 hours a day doing this. I appreciate that. What a blessing that was to be able to do this. It gave me the wherewithal to buy all of the tools to use to be able to do this. It gave me the wherewithal to have the internet presence to be able to share it. And so I am really grateful for having that, and I'm also grateful for the failures, because the last failure was so publicly humiliating, so scarring, that it profoundly changed my attitude towards criticism. I don't care. It means nothing to me. And until you get to the point that you have no ego, no concerns whatsoever about criticism, where you just don't care, you really can't do this. And so I am really grateful, and I'm also grateful just for the opportunity to be into it, to be able to share what Yahweh shared. To be, Yahweh has never operated on his own. It's not his style. Now he did. He fulfilled matzah on his own. He fulfilled pesach on his own. He fulfilled bakudim on his own. But it's not his thing. He doesn't want to operate on his own. The celebrations of these things are parties, so we all gather together. God is not a loner. He does not like to operate on his own. God did not need to call Moshe up to Mount Horeb to communicate his Torah. He is quite articulate. He could have boomed it from the top of the highest mountain. And in every community where people lived, 24/7. But that's not why he created humankind. He created us to work with us. He, like many of us, enjoys work. And so his whole style is to work together. And so to be able to work with Yahweh, to share insights in his words, is the greatest job a person can possibly have. And every single one of us is given that opportunity. Marvelous.
Oh, yeah, you know, we're all great joy. You know, I was talking to Yada today, and I was telling her, most people seem lost because they can't find their career path. And this is the majority of people, or can't find their way to success, or whatever the deal is. The truth of the matter is, at this point, we've actually, within the covenant, found success. We really have. And all we're doing now is marking time and trying to share that success, which can be very frustrating.
We do it in a gruff way.
I went into the forum and people were talking about my style as being, just attacking and this and that.
Yeah.
I don't attack people. I share Yahweh's words, and when they disagree with them.
Yeah, but by the way, wait to more people. Where I talked to Yoel today. I had about an hour conversation with Yoel. And as soon as I finish the 10th chapter, we get it edited, we're going to post observations for our time. And I know that it's posted right now on the Blessed Yahweh site and at Frank's site and other places. In the 8th chapter, what folks are going to find is that Job is having a conversation with Yahweh about Solomon. And he says, he ain't ready yet. And the reason he's not ready yet, he's not tough enough. He doesn't come across blunt and bold enough. He's just not hard enough. And if you look at the example that Yahweh and Yosha set for us, it's tough. It's hard. it's extraordinarily blunt, and I mean, Kirk, I don't know how you could have harsher language than what Yahweh used to describe Yahudah circa 745 BCE.
No, he destroyed him.
Destroyed him. Mm-hmm. And so, you know, Kirk
didn't
move
back, but he
you know, he said, I'm going to leave these signposts, the Zion, on the way, and they point right to my Torah. So I'm going to leave a remnant, and I'm going to leave the signs, and I'm going to leave my Torah, so you can find me. But there's only one place where we disagree, and that is that I will use very condescending tones and words, ignorant, irrational, moron, stupid, you know, that sort of thing. I typically don't, I'll almost never use the F-bomb. And I know that you're not using much these days either. But other than just some terminology, and by the way, there are times when you're dealing with an idiot like Wayne that you might think it, and it's passing in the back of your head that this guy really deserves that. But you know, I just won't do it. It's because of the fact that I'm concerned that by doing it and having that one statement pulled out of context, that the credibility of all the work that we're doing to share Yahweh's words can be somehow misrepresented because of the use of the term. And so I just won't do it. But other than that, I've told you, for example, when I did the translations of Chronicles to try to have a better appreciation of the life that Dode experienced with Yahweh, that the reason that Yahweh loved Dode, beyond the fact of his intellect and his passion, because he was in your face. His style, Larry, is your style. Aggressive.
Good. I'm glad to hear that. I mean, I think he was. I think he said he hated those people that were fence set.
He
hated them.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Yeah,
I do too.
It's the worst. I used to use that kind of language. I do now use very condescending language. I use very derogatory terms.
The reason that I do it,
but so
you want to know why I do it? Here's why I do it. When somebody comes to you with this fraudulent idea that they just love you, okay, and then the way they love you is this passive-aggressive nonsense.
Yeah.
I've got an answer for them right now because we're going to stop the nonsense love fest right here because
right.
You're a fraud, and I'm not.
Yeah.
And
yeah.
That's where it comes off with me, okay? That's all it is. You know, the truth is I'm actually laughing a lot of times while I'm doing this.
I know.
They're clowns.
The laughing doesn't come across in the written word.
It isn't supposed to. Because in the end, they tell me how much they hate me. And so that made them the fraud. I hated them from the minute that they decided they hated Yahweh's words. Okay?
Yeah.
I hated them from that moment on.
One of the things
I didn't
Yahweh
play the game. I love you.
Hate is absolutely required. Hate is appropriate.
Yeah.
You know, one of the problems that humans have today is we don't know what to hate or how important hate is. But the likes of Wayne's, I hate, and
sure.
We should hate, and sure. Yahweh hates. Any time that you are harming Yah's creation and misleading them, what you're doing is deserving of hate.
Okay.
That's just the way it is. That's right.
That's
killing
right.
people.
That's right.
Yeah.
So, you know, I mean, that's why I do it. It's got nothing to do with, you know, it's been very rare. It's been a while since they've actually gotten, my ire up. Okay?
Yeah.
It can be very frustrating if I'm in the middle of a work day and somebody keeps bothering me with some nonsense. And I might get my ire up then. And it's just because they're an irritant. It's not because anything they say is even substantive.
The only reason I stay away from getting mine up is that I will, I'll be bothered by somebody like this way, and I'll exchange 4 or 5 emails with them. But after a while, I stop reading them. And I'll get to a point where I'll read the first sentence, and then I said, you know, there's just...
It's always the same
I have
thing.
A choice of wasting my time with this individual and ruining my day, or I can go back to Bar Rashid and translate a couple of more sentences from Yahweh. What do you think I'm going to enjoy more? What's going to happen?
Well, I think it's the latter of the two. And
I do it, then I hit delete when I think I've said all that there needs to be said. I don't read anymore. Just hit delete and move on with doing what I enjoy doing. That's why I stopped shattering myths, because this is so much more fun.
Yeah, well, these people, they don't understand the damage. Maybe they do understand, maybe they don't. But what they're actually participating in is the damaging of Yahweh's credibility. That's what they're doing. You know, when we represent that, when we point out that Yahweh knew exactly that it took 6 days to create the
right.
universe. When we
right.
point out that the Burkle crater was the cause of the regional
right.
flood. When
and
we
Yahweh
point
actually,
out...
And Yahweh actually used that it would start with an upwelling of deep seawater.
Yeah,
and
yeah, they're wow. How strong
and then
is
you
that?
See, and then you see the Black Sea, which was around the Black Sea and down the Mesopotamias, where almost all humans with an Asama lived. And you have absolute proof at the time of the flood, at the timing of the Burkle crater, you have absolute proof that the water in the Black Sea rose 500 feet. It is still 500 feet above where those civilizations were, and that it changed at that date from fresh water to salt water. At some point along there, you've got to say, okay, he knows what he's talking about because he was there.
He was there. He saw it. You know, I understand this. And so what we're doing, we're working on Yahweh's credibility. That, you know,
right.
Yahweh's credibility. Yeah, we're sharing how incredible these words are.
Yeah.
And when he's talking about Babylon, how they're moving towards the sun, and then Halal ben Shakar, that's what his name means. That's Satan's
right.
real name.
Right.
They're all moving towards the sun.
Yeah, they're
all
moving towards
people.
The rising sun.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah. You're pointing all this stuff out.
Yeah,
exactly. So you're pointing all this stuff out, and it's all about credibility. And so you get somebody that says, you know, I've always knew there was something wrong. That's what UT's full of. You understand? People who all
right.
realize there was something wrong.
They're wrong.
And so
and they hear what Yahweh said, and it resonates.
Yeah, Yahweh's words got them.
Right.
That's it.
That's right. It resonates with them.
Because
yeah, this is exactly what I would have expected, is what we hear all the time. So it's what we've all found.
Right.
I mean, every time we find a new insight in Yahweh's testimony, like what I found that, you know, he didn't say just walk away from these things, just walk away them to from them to me. You say, of course, that's the way it needs to be. God wouldn't have you be directionless.
Yeah, well, that's one of those
important
things that I would think that somebody would understand. But that's why that's where he was going towards. Yeah, come towards me, he says, and become perfect.
Yeah, but you know, our goal is to be as precisely accurate as we're capable. Yeah,
well, no, and that's the thing I get attacked on, is that I use the most accurate translations, the whole group. It's not just me. It's the whole group now. We all get attacked on, oh, yeah, these are Wynn guys. They use these translations from Craig Wynn. And you go, do you have a better one? Do you have a better translation?
Well,
can you share
it
with
them wrong in the new way?
Yeah, you've got a better one.
I'll
use yours. I have
You know, so I use the best translations in the world, and that's what you can knock me for? That's it? That's what you've got?
Or, by the
you know,
way,
that, you're
you,
comparing
if you don't
the
like
Cub Scouts with the,
show
you know,
where they're wrong and come up with a better one.
Yeah, well, thank you, but that isn't going to happen.
You know, one of the things
it?
That I've done a lot in this book on observations is I've done a lot more comparing what the Hebrew words actually say and the English translations. I've done a lot more of that comparing because there is such a disparity between the words. I said, listen, I'm not claiming that I'm precisely right. I'm just going to tell you that what you've got in your English translation is just horribly wrong. And, you know, I've just did
two statements ago. I think it was beginning of the 15th chapter of Bar-Rashid. And there were all of these insights, and it was something like, you know, Yahweh encouraged Abram to lift up his eyes and to survey things. And he, the first thing he says is, you know, your descendants are going to be, you know, like the and it's apar, which could be the dust, sand, rubbish, debris, ash of the land. And so, you know, I did a little quick calculation, because, you know, I'm pretty astute on this kind of stuff, and I did a calculation as to how many, on average, grains of sand or dirt would be in a cubic foot and just a square foot.
Yeah.
You know, in a cubic foot, it's a billion, and a square foot, it's a thousand. And then I got, well, how many square feet are there in a square mile, and how many square miles is Yisrael? About 200,000 and 8 million square miles. I did the math, and it's 200 trillion. Has Abraham had 200 trillion descendants?
No. So that's not what it says.
All right, so it's not talking about that. So I said, all right, so what do these words mean? How can I translate the Hebrew word for count? Are there other alternatives, like to reckon, to discern, to understand? Oh, yeah, those will work. And what is it about Afar that is interesting? What can I distinguish between those who are properly nourished and who have been set apart and those who have been assigned to a place of reckoning? Those who are dust to dust, dirt to dirt. And I began to look at it and said, here are your possibilities. I said, how about any one of these 10, which are all profound? And then I went through and said, now, none of that's going to be an English translation. And then he went through and he says, I want you to look at the breadth and the width of Yisrael. And by the way, the term for breadth and the term for width, stunningly profound in terms of the specifics of what Yahweh is going to provide to his covenant children. What they said is, if you can look at this, you're going to understand that my whole goal is to enhance you in every possible way, to make you immortal, to perfect you, to enrich and to empower you. That's what I want you to lift up your eyes and see. It had nothing to do with width and breadth, but everything to do with the honoring the nature of the covenant. And now, if you're going to read your English translation, you're going to get none of that. And you end up with something that's just irrelevant, as opposed to the one statement had four of the five benefits of the covenant. The only one it didn't have is Yahweh paying the ransom necessary to perfect us on matzah. But the next sentence says, oh, by the way, I am the one who's going to protect and deliver you, and I'm going to do it by paying the ransom necessary to provide the fare for you to get from where you are to where I want you to be. Very next sentence. And so what you have is all five benefits of the covenant presented. You're going to find that in English translation. Not one. You know, it's the beauty of amplification, of looking at what the words mean. That's what, Kirk, I think you're finding such pleasure in, is looking at what the words mean and growing as a result of that understanding.
Well, if you were off, I mean, I use the same stuff that you do. I probably don't have sophisticated stuff online, but I certainly, there's not a word that you're translating that I haven't been able to find, and if I work hard enough, there's nothing there that's that you've said is not even off compared to that. I mean,
you've got to look at all of the words that share the same root in terms of those letters. What do they convey when those same letters are used in under vocalizations? What is the actionable verbal root?
Right.
How did Yahweh define the term? What do the letters,
the
original pictographic letters, what do they convey?
Let me ask you a question along those lines. So I got an email from Chris, and her husband, you know, are relatively new to the current family, and she asked me about some translating, and she happened to ask about a particular verse that I had already gone over with Roy. So I sent a copy of that. But the question she had is...
Roy's doing like, translations now, too?
Yeah.
Okay.
Well,
I
a little bit.
When
we talk...
Because Roy sent me a correction on one of my translations on a pronoun. And it was it's the first time I'd ever seen him do that, and it was happened to be on the cow, you know, the cow, the one who's observant knows its maker, and the cow was written in the is a feminine term, and the and therefore the pronoun associated with the cow was feminine, and so he sent me that correction. And it was the first time I had seen a correction from him that was actually based on going to in the work of translation. So I was pretty impressed with that. That's a really good thing. With his mind,
well,
he ought to be really good at it.
Well, he asked me, he said, you know, I'm going through a logos and all this stuff, and I'm not getting what you got. So I said, well, let me go ahead and translate that and see if I can find, and I did it without looking at yours so much because I don't want to get ahead, you know, I don't want to try to prove you right. So I went out separately, but I did my normal due diligence as best I know how.
Right.
And I said, okay, here's all my research. And I sent it all to him handwritten, so he barely could read it, but he said, oh, yeah, also there's a couple of words that I was looking for, and yeah, that is what, you know, I didn't find that. So that prompts my question
by the
now.
Way, getting to find that?
Uh-huh.
It took me a very long, I've been doing this for 15 years.
Yeah.
It took a very long time to find it, to come up with the proper perspective and mindset and to know what to look for to find it. And finally, Larry, I've mentioned this just in our last program, is that starting with this book, I changed my approach, which is that if there's a word that I've translated 1,000 times before, I won't translate it anymore without looking it up and looking up every possible implication of that word, because that's where the learning takes place.
Yeah.
So
well,
but
let me
discipline. You've got to know how to look for the verbal root. You've got to look for, you've got to strip away the diacritical markings, because the diacritical markings is how the words are presented in the lexicons. And if you don't strip away the diacritical markings, it didn't even come to exist until the 11th century CE, you're hindering your understanding.
Yeah.
Because that Shoah system was specific, and Shoah is based upon Shab. It means to deceive, to corrupt,
yeah,
to pervert. So you've got to strip away that system, and then you've got to look up all the verbal roots, and you've got to have this filter that says, all right, if I'm reading something here, whether it be in Strong's or one of the many other lexicons,
right,
if I'm reading something here that is inconsistent with the sentence, inconsistent with Yahweh, inconsistent with the context, but is consistent with the mentality of Christianity in English translations, you know, I've got to be careful to disregard that.
Yeah, or go find out what they missed and put it back in. You know, so
yeah,
you know,
like for example, when Wayne might say that Kodesh means to set apart. I mean, not Kodesh, but Kodesh, the CH as opposed to Kodesh, the Q. And there may be some lexicon out there that has misrepresented that aspect of it, when in fact it is the Q, Kodesh, that is set apart, and the CH, Kodesh, is month and means to renew. So there is always misinformation in them. I mean, you can look at Strong's, and it'll say that Yod Hey Wah Hey is the Lord.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
All day long.
I mean, all day long. And so there's lots of misinformation out there, so you do have to have a filter.
Yeah. Well, yeah. So my question was I didn't want to say, go buy this one, this one, this one, this one. What do you think are probably about the, before I talk to her, some of the things I do, because what are the ones on your list that are most critical, do you think? Do you remember
what
your
words?
List on, like, yeah, well, no, the lexicons or the interlinearies. I mean, what do you advise somebody who's just getting started because I got a lot, you know, now.
Okay, but, yeah, I mean, I have a lot as well. I would say that my favorite is Dictionary of Biblical Languages Hebrew, DBL. That's my favorite.
Is that on
That's
there?
The first one. The first one I go to. Yeah. Dictionary of Biblical Language is Hebrew. It's the first one I go to virtually all the time. It's not linked to any translation, and it presents the clearest, fastest way to survey, and it's also the cleanest for looking at the words with the diacritical markings removed. So you're removing the artificial vowels and just looking at the letters. It's faster for me to scan the DBL Hebrew than it is Dictionary of Biblical Languages Hebrew than it is any other text. So that's the first one I go to. The second one I go to is Strong's, because although I will always I transliterate now from the Hebrew letters of the word itself, but I want to make certain that I'm using the nominal version of the word, because you know the word in Hebrew, the verb, you know, could have letters added for feminine or masculine, first, second, or third person as pronouns. It could have a letter added for preposition. It could have a letter added for a conjunction. It could have a letter added for the if it's a verb, a mood, a conjunction, or a stem. And you can't look up the words with those things on them. So I want to make sure that I have properly stripped the Hebrew of that, so that the words you can actually look up. And and then I look at Strong's because Strong's usually does a good job of transliteration. In other words, if there's a word that had that where the O sound comes from the W, they'll include it. They do a better job. They're not totally accurate, but they do the best job of what I think is insightful transliteration.
I agree with that.
It's like in old Wayne World, he would have Yahowah, but he didn't present the fact he removed two of the letters of Yahweh's name to replace them with English vowels, which takes you away from the fact that that letter is pronounced that way. And you know, it's like Torah. You can write Torah without the W, but that's where the O sound comes from. So I think you're actually misleading doing the transliteration that way. So I'll use Strong's for that. And I think Strong's also is right about the root about 70% of the time. I disagree with Strong's on the root about 30% of the time. And it's pretty obvious when they're wrong.
That's okay. But still, I agree,
Yeah, and then the next one I go to that I think is always thorough, but it's very Christian, is the Theological Word Book of the Old Testament, TWOT, the Theological Word Book of the Old Testament, very thorough. And they have a lot of essays on words. And then there's a BDB, which what in the world is so I... trying to see if I have a name for it, but the acronym for it is DBD. The thing about them that I like is that they have in Lagos a linkable capability to every place the word is used, and you know, if the word that's used a lot of different ways, they'll say, well, it's used to inherit here. It's used as heir here. It's used as possession here. And that's in terms of the English translations. And I can mouse over those sections and say, all right, what can I learn from the way that it's used in these places, and where is Yahweh defining it, and can I come up with a definition that is consistent throughout all of those? And they'll go through very scholastic studies of various people's dissertations on how they came up with the meaning of a word. I would say they're right maybe 50% of the time they're right. They're really helpful, but I don't use them mostly for I don't use them at all for definitions, but I do use them as a research tool. So I use them as a research tool.
Okay. Well, that one doesn't seem to be on your list there, so the DVD, so so it must be just in logos.
I want to see if I can find the name of it. It doesn't have it there. No, I mean, every one of the Logos books has comes with a, I mean, is purchasable in a printed form. I don't use the printed forms anymore. The only thing I use the printed form for is I use a Strong's Concordance. If there's a, if I'm doing something, I'm going to say, okay, what is the, you know, are there a variety of Hebrew words for one thing or another? And so I will look up. I'll use a concordance sometimes just to be fully appraised of all the ways that a word can be rendered. And or I'll look up and say, you know, boy, I've never seen a word for that. The other day I was looking up and said, does God even have a word for that? And so I use Strong's Concordance to say, is there any Hebrew word that's translated that way? And no. So I'll use the Strong's for that. And sometimes I'll use a concordance that has the number of times the word is used and how many times and where it's used in each of the books, because that's helpful. You know, is this a word that Yahshayah uses a lot but other people don't? The word that Dode uses a lot but other people don't? The word that appears in the Torah a lot but not other places? And then you can go, when was the word first defined? So I find that's another tool that I use a lot.
Okay, now when
that answers your question, but that's...
Well, one other question, though. When you...
Now, one thing I do say is I think you need to have at least one interlinear.
Yeah.
I think the interlinears are really helpful. The reason the interlinears are helpful is that they will present the words in the order that they appear with the Hebrew and the English juxtaposed, and they do a decent job of presenting the pronouns and the conjunctions so that you're looking at the words and say, all right, this conjunction is associated, this preposition is here, is a first person singular masculine, right. You know,
sentence flow without them. So at least you can
I think that an interlinear is helpful.
So do you use the Lexham or the Zondervan or what? Those are the ones
on interlinears. Lexham is the one that I use the most.
Lexham, okay.
Yeah.
All right.
That's the one I use the most. It's called the Lexham Hebrew English interlinear. It's the one that I. Oh, by the way, the BDB is called the actual name is Enhanced Brown Driver Briggs.
Oh, Brown and Driver.
Enhanced Driver Briggs Hebrew and English Lexicon.
Yes. Okay. Yeah,
that one has a lot of tools in it that I find very helpful.
Yes, I got that one. Okay.
I know I've found it helpful, for me to take the New Testament, and I've used X-ray microcroscopy. I've decided to go to that.
Oh, okay.
So
that's
I can get
better
look.
That's a helpful thing, too.
Look at the trash. And, I can verify it's from the swamp.
One of the things, by the way, you also need is a Hebrew grammar, because you've got... you've got stems, conjugations, moods. There's things called a participle. You know, a participle is a verbal adjective, for example. There's absolute forms. There's construct forms. And, of course, then there's the moods. And volition is expressed in first, second, and third person in the moods between the cohortative, the jussive, and the imperative. You have the first, second, and third person volition. So it's important to be attuned to the conjugation of the moods. There's some conjugations that, for example, say that when Yahweh was asking Abram to walk, the stem that he used is a walk. I want you to walk on your own initiative, independently, without the help or influence of anybody. In other words, I don't want you to be influenced by society, by religion, by your wife, by by anybody. I want you to do this on your own initiative, of your own and independently. There's actually a stem that conveys that. independently without any outside influence.
So what do you use now to find those, that kind of information?
One of the nice things about Logos, I've got the most expensive version you can have of Logos, but I probably have invested $20,000 in my Logos because I've got everything that you can have in it. But Logos does a nice job of presenting on the verbs what the stem is, what the conjugation is if it's there, and what the moods are, as well as what's an absolute, what's a possessive form, a construct form, what is a verbal adjective, a participle form, what's the infinite form. It does a nice job of that. And most of those, you know, I've done this enough that I don't recognize what they are. But still, you know, I'll double check. I want to know, what the hiphil form you see a lot, the peel form you see a lot, the pool form you see a lot. You know, and there are stems that say that the hiphil form, the subject causes the object to be an understudy. In other words, that the subject is influencing the object under the action of the verb such that the object becomes a secondary subject. Now, that might sound complicated, but it really isn't. That means that if God is saying, I want to uplift you, room, as it relates to your nature, that means that God is causing Abram, or the subject, to benefit from this such that he becomes like and experiences it from Yahweh's perspective, the hiphil stem. Marvelous stem. There are stems like the pool in Hebrew, where it says, in essence, that you're not just carrying out you're not just influencing the action of the verb, but you're also affected by the action of the verb. There are places, for example, where those who are promoting religion are not just perpetrating the lie, but they're actually themselves influenced and affected by the lie. The pool stem. So these stems are really interesting stuff. Of course, the call stem means there's no nuanced meaning here. This is literal, genuine, and actual in developing the relationship between the subject and the object.
Mm-hmm.
So I really like the stems, and I ran into the jussive mood ascribed in a passage of volitional, but it's third person volition, and it was ascribed to the land. The land was the only third-person character in the sentence, and so it means that the land had a will, had a desire. And so the only way that the land can have a will or desire is for that land to represent something more than the dirt.
Yeah.
That land has to be Yahweh's home and family for it to have a desire and will.
Yeah, that's pretty personal.
But it was written in the Joseph.
Wow. That's really wild.
So, when Yahweh tells Abram, this is what I want you to do, he doesn't write it as in the cohortative form, which would be, this is what I want you to do, this is my will. He writes it instead in the imperative form, which is, this is your choice.
Mm-hmm.
You should choose, but this is your choice.
So,
there's a lot of things that really go into it. I mean, and you also have sentence structure where in Hebrew the sentence structure is very different than English, and so sometimes you have to reorder the Hebrew words to have them make sense in English, because Hebrew isn't subject-object, or subject-verb-object.
Mm-hmm.
And that's the way we communicate in English. And in English we said that, it's a red wagon. We modify the noun with the adjective before the noun rather than in Hebrew. In Hebrew, for example, we would say the set apart spirit. But in Hebrew, it's spirit.
Set apart. Sure, of course. Right. It's almost like backwards.
But so when I'm rendering the Hebrew and I'll say Ruach Kodesh, well, it's actually Kodesh Ruach.
Ruach, everybody knows.
It's Ruach Kodesh, which is spirit set apart. That's the right way in Hebrew.
Yeah, that's the
then
Hebrew.
I'll render it in English, not spirit set apart, but set apart spirit. It's just that in Hebrew, like a lot of languages, the modifiers follow the noun as opposed to precede the noun.
Now, is it what I normally tell people when they ask me is that the thing that helped me the most, anybody can buy lexicons, you can look it up, but I read all this stuff a lot. So I at least had a good perspective going in, so I knew when I was being conned in a dictionary.
Yeah.
I knew that's wrong. That's what I like
to talk about.
It says
Yahweh is and who he is and what he isn't. As Larry likes to say, he's not a religious deity. Until you come to know that, you're really not in a position to go through this, because most of these tools are provided by and published by Christian religious institutions. The publishers themselves are religious. And they want to support their religion.
They want to
you have to be able to back that away.
Yeah. And it's like, I hadn't really thought about it greatly, but like today we were talking about the, one of the answers I never give people about why he says don't pray and don't worship and everything was just the simple fact that where is it in the covenant agreement that where it says do these things? He tells you the five benefits, the
He never once said, pray to me. Never once said, worship me. He never did say, Shabbat me on the right day.
Yeah.
Shabbat me on the Enoch calendar, dude.
Yeah. Well, one thing is what's funny, ironic about that letter that y'all were talking about is that I always flash back on the time that JB, when you were doing Question at Paul very early on, he did his little study on Devarim where he says this is the idea about a prophet, and if you do this and you do that, and Paul failed miserably, therefore reject him right away. I mean, a rational person shouldn't need a whole lot of reasons to reject it. And he basically said the same thing when he did that study on Enoch. If he's trying to be a prophet, you can say the same thing about Muhammad, of course, but, you've got to be in that case anyway with him. But that's just another perspective thing. Once you know, you know.
Once you know, you know. So, yeah, that's the beauty of all of this is that somewhere along the line, you go from wondering and learning and being curious and investigating, but somewhere just along the line, you know.
Yeah.
And you don't know really what that's like until you get somewhere along the range like Dode got to. He just says, I know.
Mm-hmm.
Complete confidence.
You're at a point now that there's things you take for granted. You don't even think about it.
I just
know them. And I just don't need, I just straight up know them. There is something I want to mention to you about. You asked, how many times have you made a mistake and said, I really screwed up here because, I could have went further. I mean, if somebody couldn't figure out they had to be walking towards Yahweh to be perfect, I mean, you wrote that in.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, but so you didn't say it. Okay, great. They didn't read it then. Here's the thing. I remember a show, and this was not two or three months ago, where you said, well, what I know about the Torah, and I'm going to be kind to myself, is about a billionth of there is to know. And that's being kind. Okay, that's because you understand the depth of it. I do, too.
Right.
I believe if you knew the Torah inside out and backwards, you could make a universe, or at least a galaxy.
Well, I do too.
So I'm nowhere near...
If we could get to the point where the Torah, we and the Torah were one, we'd be indistinguishable from Yahweh.
By the way,
we're going to be really close to that one day.
I know, and the reason that's one of the reasons that exponentially we have to grow is because in our little pea brain, the way it sets today. And I'll speak for myself. We couldn't engage those billions of things that we don't know.
Yeah.
I mean,
no,
we couldn't. We,
no.
And so we
but,
have
but,
to
but,
be amplified
somewhere along the
in
way,
order
Larry,
to even
you just
have
come
a
to a point where you just know everything fits.
Yes.
You're comfortable with who Yahweh is, what he has offered, how we've responded. You don't worry. You have no concerns. You're relaxed in the whole relationship. You know, it's like, what was the when Yahweh actually appeared the first time as visually to Abram? You know, and he's a infinity times infinity diminished from his total natural state. The first thing he says, hey, relax. Don't be worried. Don't be anxious. Don't be afraid. Just relax. Let's be comfortable together. God doesn't want us to be all hyped up. He wants us to be comfortable and relaxed. And once you come to know him and understand what he's offering, you relax around him. I'm very comfortable around him. And I know I'm a flawed dude who makes a gazillion mistakes. That doesn't change the fact I'm really comfortable around him.
Yeah.
Well, I mean, you know what?
Settle right up to
it. The whole PR firm, Hollywood makeup man, and all this, you know, scripted speeches and all, it doesn't exist in the real world. You know that.
No,
I know that.
Right.
You talked about if you got up every day and looked like you look and your wife got up every day and she looked at her most beautiful, you'd really feel out of place.
Yeah.
Right? I mean,
right,
come
right.
on. And so, yeah,
God yeah. doesn't expect us to dress up. Doesn't even, you know, one of the things I noticed about Abram, and I wrote it in this 10th chapter, is that he's a bit of a dunderhead. I mean, this man is not the sharpest tool in the shed. He is literally the antithesis of Dod. He's not very smart. He just doesn't get it. And it's over and over again. You know, one of the things I noticed is that his response to Yahweh completely misunderstood the entire purpose of the Torah. He's telling, you know, Yahweh, wait a minute, you're offering me all this inheritance and I don't have a kid.
Sounds a lot like an apostle.
The covenant ain't your family, Abraham. It's Yahweh's family.
Right.
See,
yeah.
You are the kid, Abraham. It's not about your kid. It's about you being the kid. You know, you're missing the entire point. You're not the dad. Yahweh's the dad. And you just go, okay, this is not the sharpest tool in the shed.
Oh.
But there's a huge advantage of that. It says that Yahweh wasn't expecting a lot, was very patient with him, took the time to explain it to him, and that means you don't have to be a rocket. You don't have to be a Roy. By the way, Roy wrote a very nice letter. JB, I hope you got a copy of it. About your review of Enoch. But you don't have to have the intellect of Roy to be part of the covenant. Does it help? Yeah. I mean, it puts you in the league of a Dod where these insights just materialize in your head that are so helpful and exciting. But you don't. Abraham is part of the covenant, and I want to tell you, he was not the sharpest tool in the shed.
Kirk and I at our last Mensa meeting were kind of laughing at you, you know, and what
right,
all you
right.
have
well,
to glean from
no
us all
that.
The time.
Well,
I know.
Yeah.
Remember that, Kirk?
Yeah.
You know, we were having
fun.
A drink laughing about how stupid Yada was. No, we shouldn't have done that.
We apologized profusely.
Well, what we came to realize is you don't really have to have an exciting IQ to walk into the covenant.
No,
you just have to be real.
No. Yeah,
well, the good news is understanding
right
is not defined
right
by IQ.
Open mind, desire to learn, and a willingness to say, all right, well, I had that wrong. Okay.
Now, you know, I felt like Kirk got a little out of line. You know, I mean, really ragging on you and everything. But,
I'm the
you know, we got it under control. Remember all the Mensa people? We had them laughing. And everybody had a good time. It was at your expense, Yada, but, you know.
But that's fine. I
know.
I'm delighted.
I know.
And if I had been there, I probably would have been laughing the hardest.
Probably.
I know I would.
Yeah.
One of the things about writing Yada Yah and Intro to God and now Observations is what you do is you put yourself out there.
Sure.
You open yourself up for criticism. And particularly if you take the time to explain, these are all the thought process and the reason for this. You give people a million ways, a billion ways.
You give them the ammunition, sure you do.
To get all
sure.
the ammunition in the world. And if you're doing then a show about these books that's extemporaneous, you're giving him even more ammunition. And so you can't do this if you've got thin skin. Because you're going to keep all the ammunition in the world to tear you to ribbons.
By the way, that you guys have got to see the movie Stanley White. I mean, really, you've got to see. Yeah, don't miss Stanley White, the movie. The story of a hardworking, responsible white man slogging through the day-to-day rigors of being productive while fighting the societal bigotry associated with political correctness. Can Stanley overcome the uneven playing field and lack of empathy advanced by the Oprah Winfrey crowd? Take this thrilling ride and see if Stanley can remain productive while wading through the scathing path of destruction advanced by the politically correct, all while hiding his dirty little secret. You see, Stanley is straight. And that's it. I mean, you know, that's going to be the movie of the year. Yeah,
That is funny. I did see Jason Bourne, the movie the other day, and and a lot of it's way too gratuitous in terms of the violence, but the portrayal of the CIA in that movie is
so accurate. Yeah.
Oh. It's accurate.
It's scathing.
It is so scathingly sickening. And I kept on thinking, boy, am I glad I'm not doing Shattering Myths anymore. Boy, am I glad I'm not doing Shattering Myths. Because you know that if you continue to poke the NSA and the CIA, that eventually they're going to poke back. And the way they poke back is they mount a fraudulent case against you. And they absolutely will create the evidence to expose and condemn you. And for what? And for what?
Well, you know,
I'd much rather be doing what I'm doing now, and I think we're serving a purpose now, and I'd serve no purpose sitting there in jail because they want to set me up.
Well, you know, the other thing about it is, too, at one time, Shattering Mist was third most listened to show on GCN Network, wasn't it?
Yeah, it was. Yeah.
I mean, it really was. Then Kirk came.
And by the way, we
even had a show
on the top guy because right after I left with the top show, Alex Jones. Yeah, Alex Jones was 100% conspiracy, and while I was there, the week I left, he went to Scott, who now does his show most of the time, and he said, "I had an epiphany. I'm losing all of my credibility. I'm so damn tired talking about these conspiracies. We're going to do this show straight. So from now on, no conspiracy callers. I want to do commentaries on the news that are insightful and useful and as accurate and as meaningful as I can make them. We're going to make this show mainstream.
Yeah.
And I'm going to be credible."
He said that. Yeah, that's pretty amazing.
I point that out just so those